Let us pray. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam. Blessed art thou, Lord our God, King of the universe. Heavenly Father, you have given us the gift of wisdom. You have given us the gift of grace and clarity. Lord, we ask that those who are present tonight would use those gifts, that we would be good stewards of our earth and of our city. Make decisions that are mindful and are pleasing to all. May our voices be filled with your grace and your love. We pray these things in your precious and holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance by Councilmember Gilmore.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ms. Williams, roll call, please.
Mayor McPartlin.
Here.
Vice Mayor Adams has asked for an excused absence. Councilmember Coy.
Here.
Councilmember Gilmore.
Here.
And Councilmember Hill has asked for an excused absence.
All right, Council, any agenda modifications?
Mayor, I wonder if we could contemplate
moving public comment a little later in the, it looks like we're going to have a light agenda. And I spoke with one of our citizens at the moonshot moment. He was wanting to come and speak. He said, I may be a few minutes late. And so I don't know, but if we could make the public input after new business, it'd give them a little bit more time to get here. Looks like we're gonna have a pretty quick agenda.
Sure, I don't have any problem with that.
Okay.
You have any problem with that, Ms. Coy?
No,
okay. All right. All right, that brings us up to proclamations, awards, and brief announcements. Mr. Griffin, you have an item?
Yes, sir, and good evening. It's my pleasure to introduce Mr. Jim Romanek. Jim is the newest member of our management team. He is our purchasing agent and contracts administrator. He comes from a town in Illinois where he was an executive there. He has a lot of experience with purchasing and contracts administration. Jim also used to work for Indian River County, so in a sense, he's coming back home. Please, I'd like to welcome him to the City of Sebastian, and thank you very much. Jim, would you like to say a few words?
Sure. I'd just like to thank the city and Mr. Griffin for the opportunity to be here, and I look forward to working for the city and helping out in any way I can.
All right. Thank you. Council, any questions for Mr. Romanek? All right. Welcome and good luck. All right. Any other brief announcements, Council? No? All right. We'll recess as the City Council and reconvene as the Community Redevelopment Agency. Roll call, Ms. Williams.
Chairman McPartlin.
Here.
Vice Mayor Adams has asked for an excused absence. Councilmember Coy.
Here.
Councilmember Gilmore.
Here.
And Councilmember Hill has asked for an excused absence.
All right. Leads us up to approval of the March 23rd CRA minutes.
Move approval.
Second.
Roll call, Ms. Williams.
Ms. Coy?
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore?
Yes.
Chairman McPartlin?
Yes.
Thank you.
All right, leads us up to item 7C, approve the amending the FY15-16 CRA budget to appropriate project funds from the shoreline stabilization to the landscape enhancement of the Cav Corps and overflow parking. Mr. Griffin.
Yes, sir. About a year ago, we appropriated funds for shoreline stabilization at the working waterfront. Since that time, it became apparent that we were going to be able to go and make an application to find for a seawall project for the working waterfront area. That application cannot be submitted until about this time next year, and we're estimating about a $300,000 project amount. We are requesting that the funds that were originally allocated for shoreline stabilization, $20,000 and change, be moved over towards landscape enhancement for the Cav Corps project and perhaps any future project that we do at the South Overflow parking area. Marissa Moore, our community development director, came to me with this suggestion. I think it's certainly a valid suggestion, so we can get appropriate landscape in the CAVCOR project, which is just getting ready to kick off. Mercer, would you like to add anything?
I just wanted to say that I intend on the landscaping to be as low maintenance as possible, and I think it would be a really good addition to the aesthetics of the area down there.
All right. Thank you. Council, any questions for Mr. Griffin or Ms. Moore?
No.
Yeah, I just would have a comment. I think for going forward, we ought to really look closely at the living shoreline option instead of the seawall. They've done lots of studies where the living shoreline does lots better in storms than than seawalls, and I think it'd be a lot cheaper to maintain. It would clean the water. I'm just saying, in the future, rather than go into a project that's $100,000 or very expensive, I think we ought to look into the living shoreline option for the working waterfront. That's all.
All right.
I'll be glad to look at that. Take a look.
All right. Council, I get a motion for?
So moved.
Second.
All right. Ms. Williams, roll call, please.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so that moves along. All right, item 7D, approve the facade, sign, and landscape grant award to Dawn Beal for office building. Mr. Griffin.
Dory Bosworth wrote up this report, so I'll let her handle the presentation. Dory.
This was an application for our facade, sign, and landscape grant. It is from Ms. Dawn Beal, and the property is at 709 Washington Street. So this is near the area, the intersection of Indian River Drive and Washington Street. It's the old Greg Gore law offices. Ms. Beal is the new property owner. They would like to remove the old Greg Gore sign that has been there. It is damaged, it's faded, and they would like to replace it with a new sign. It went through the staff sign review group, grant review group. We did have a couple suggestions. We wanted to, the original sign did not have the monument base. They've presented something that will be, it's on your page, it's a dock pole type of monument base, similar to what they have at the Tiki Bar. It is going to be three panels. We wanted to make sure, to keep it with the old fishing village, it was more of a wood matted look, not the shiny metal. They have complied with that. All of the other requirements of the grant have been met, and staff recommends approval. The grant would be for their projected costs are going to be $5,400, and we are recommending a grant of $2,700, up to $700 for that grant and that application.
Council, any questions for staff?
No, just a comment. It's a very attractive looking sign. A lot of work went into the design. Thank you.
Just one question. Are we going to be approving the sign that's as it appears on page 19 or 20?
Sorry, I don't have that. The one was to show that it is the sign on page 20 with the base on page 19.
Okay.
So the 19 showed where they had added the monument base, and they added a note that it would not be shiny, the shiny metallic sign, but it would
but
be matte.
The monument base is like, is that just poles, kind of?
It's going to be the wood dock poles. It will have some, they have a little side notation there. They will be wrapping some rope around it. Proposing, I believe, the $575 worth of landscaping. What you see on 19 and 20 does not depict that.
Okay.
But there will be some mulch and some landscaping plants around the sign.
Okay. Thank you. It looks very nice.
Can I get a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
Anyone from the public wish to speak about this issue? Right. Roll call, Ms. Williams.
Mr. Gilmore.
Yes.
Chairman McPartland.
Yes.
Ms. Coy.
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. Very good. That passes. So we'll adjourn the CRA meeting and reconvene as the City Council, and that leads us up to item number 9, the consent agenda.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to pull item H for discussion, please.
Item H?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Mayor, move approval on items number A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and I, and J.
Second. All right. Roll call on those, Ms. Williams.
Mayor McPartland?
Yes.
Ms. Coy?
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. All right, item 9H, Ms. Coy.
I pulled this because I have concerns that the application is just an application. There's no depiction of what streets are to be closed. This is a 5K run that's being done in July. It's a little bit warm. You want some water stations. You might want to make provisions for an ambulance. And there is absolutely nothing but an application. And I would refer you to item J, which is an application for an event that includes pictures and where everything's going to be placed. It's a completed application. I'm sitting here looking at, I don't know if these guys have ever run a 5K before. And if someone gets injured and there's no provisions for water or anything of that, I'm just concerned that this is not well thought out. And so I would ask that we ask them to a conditional approval, because I know we're running out of time, but they go back and sit down with Marissa and the recreation department and beef this up. Tell them what they're going to do, because there's been really little to no contact. Is that true, Marissa? Have they contacted you?
They came in and filled out the road closure application as is presented in the agenda packet. They do have a meeting scheduled with us for next week. We're trying to get people in this habit of coming in and submitting the drawings with their application. But as of yet,
they have gotten the word that you want some more information and require that. Then I would like to make a conditional approval that as long as it meets Park and Rec's, as long as they're satisfied, I'm okay with it. And we need to just get into a better cycle of events here so that, because I just don't like half a job and I want to make your job as easy as possible too. So I would recommend that we conditionally approve that pending Parks and Rec's approval. Is that a decent motion? Is that a good motion, Mr. City Attorney?
I'll consider the condition an amendment. Move to approve as you've amended it.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll second that, just with a comment that If you look at page 60, it does say where, if approved, Indian River Drive from Harrison Street north to Jackson Street will be closed from 7 a.m. till 9 a.m. But I do agree that it would be good to have more information and water and
maybe where the water stations are, et cetera. Yeah, ambulance is usually a requirement. If it's not a requirement, it should be in the future for our events. That's anyway. Okay.
All right. We've got a motion and a second. Anyone from the public wish to speak on this 5K race? That's the only other question. I would think, you know, you'd come in and apply for a race more than 6 weeks before the event. I mean, this looks like, you know, basically they're given just a little over a month for a race. You know, there's no requirement. Like, I could come in, and as long as if I wanted to do a race this Saturday and it got before council tonight, I could have that race on Saturday.
We try to accommodate this as much as we can, and we send it to the police department and vet it with them as far as the volunteers to man the road closures and things like that. I mean, if it's at all possible, we try to accommodate people. Now, perhaps we've been a little bit too lenient in the past in not requiring these things that Councilmember Coy was in their application that Councilmember Coy referred to. There are a couple 5K runs that are very well managed by I think it's the Runners Depot, mm-hmm, down in Vero Beach. They do an excellent job, water stations, very well managed. They're very appreciative. They give us a lot of notice. This one kind of didn't, but I'll leave it up to Marissa to make sure that when they come in that they're put on notice that they have to have these things with a proper map, water stations, ambulance service, things like that, and She and I will talk about this tomorrow.
I think we need, Council, to have the discussion, a bigger discussion about these 5K races, because it seems like every time we turn around now, there's another one and another one. It's like a couple every month. We have at least one going on, and it's getting more and more and more. What obligation do we have? I mean, is it, I have some questions about having fundraisers and using our staff overtime, because it starts at 6 a.m, and shutting down streets and blocking off the boat ramp and blocking off access for our citizens. I think we need to talk about that. Is that the right thing to be doing, you know, over and over and over again? I don't know. But I don't feel good about doing a lot of 5K runs. And you know, what's the purpose of this 5K run? We're a fundraiser. Maybe we could raise funds running somewhere else other than, I don't know. I think there are some alternatives, and we need to have this discussion.
Everybody wants to run down by the river.
I know, it's so beautiful, but you know, you get, the boaters are gonna start, Ben is here tonight, there's Ben in the back, and he's not gonna be happy that we're shutting that street down, especially if he's in line to put his boat in. And anyway, for a later time, bring it up for, I think we need to discuss that.
All right, sounds good. Well, we have a motion and a second. Roll call on, was that 9H, Ms. Williams?
Mayor McPartlin.
Yes.
Ms. Coy.
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore.
Yes.
All right, that passes. Brings us up to committee reports and appointments. Anyone have anything to report?
No.
No? Okay. Public hearings, we have none. Unfinished business, item 12A, consider options to rename Wave Street and direct staff accordingly. Mr. Griffin.
Yes, sir. After the last meeting, Mr. Ingwe made a presentation about renaming Wave Street to Dr. McAdams, Martha McAdams Drive. I tasked Dory Bosworth in our Community Development Department to do some investigating with 911, emergency services, et cetera. I had cited an incident that kind of left a bad taste in my mouth when I went through the process of changing a street name. And what came out of that meeting was that there were three options: naming a traffic loop on site, have two names for the one street, or formally change the name of the street. Dory, if you'd like to come up and just reiterate what the emergency services folks talked to you about.
I had spoken to Paula Cantlin. She's the 911 database. My question specifically to her was, do they approve, or what were their feelings or any processes for a street with two names, an alias is what they call it. 10th Street, also known as Dodd or Town Boulevard or something like that. Down in the county, they do not approve street names with an alias street name anymore. They're not allowed. So that would be more of the, if we were going to do Wave Street, also known as Dr. McAdams Drive, something like that. I did not talk to her about a formal change. The other option was to, through a resolution, City Council would approve a name change. There would be an application, a fee from the applicant. We would research to make sure that name is not in a database anywhere else. Post office would be okay with that. We'd do a research. If it's approved by resolution from council, after that we send out letters to, there are 19 agencies that we have to send out to let them know that this is being changed. Now, how they change it in their database is up to them, their processes, which may have been an issue or problem when it was with the golf course on, you know, maybe somebody's database didn't get changed with the new name, and that's why there was the confusion on that incident at the golf course. Or the other third recommendation or third option was to name a loop or a building on the campus themselves. Wave Street, another thing we did as we were thinking this through, Wave Street, a very small section of that is platted in the Sebastian Highlands. and you're coming off George Street. The rest of it is in a private subdivision. And when we had looked at some undeveloped property in the Chester's Gap commercial subdivision, the townhouses and specifically the RV resort, we had requested that the entrance into that property would be lined up with Wave Street, so there wasn't any additional traffic with school at those times when school was letting in. So consideration that maybe by lining up that street, that would be an extension of that street name into the undeveloped property. Now, whether that's a conflict or a good thing or a bad thing, it was just something that we considered if we did rename Wave Street. It would be an extension of that new name street. We presented that information to Joe. At this time, we're recommending to name a loop on the site.
Any questions for staff?
Not for staff. I'm curious to see how the loop idea went over at the school. Could we talk to Mr. Ingwe is here?
Sure.
Another piece of paper, yes.
The civics teacher and me did some homework. I gave it to you.
I'll repeat my name. I'm Bill Ingwe. I live at 626 Layport Drive, Sebastian, Florida. And as a good civics teacher, I went out and did some homework, and I gave this very paper to Mr. Griffin through Ms. Bosworth, and we had a great conversation yesterday. In essence, what I learned was I went to the police department and discovered where I put down Sebastian Police Department. I spoke to Assistant Chief Witt, and I know he's going to be here this evening if you want to ask him a question or two, but in general, I sensed that he had no issue with a name change, sure, as long as everything was done to assure everyone would know about it. Then I went to the Sebastian crew at Barber Street and spoke to them, and they said when anyone calls from a business or a school, they don't just say 782 Wave, they say the name of the business or the school. So everyone knows the school. The address is not done alone. And then I did the same work that Ms. Bosworth did. I called Paula Catlin, and she indicated that a number of things are done. Every 3 months, maps are changed. Dispatchers confirm the address, the phone number. Right away, the screen gets populated with information, such as an alert that the name of the street has been changed until such time that's necessary any longer. Any 911 call goes to the police, continues to the fire department, the ambulance, emergency, sheriff's department. The alert is on the screen. I didn't think there was an issue. I don't think Ms. Canton thought there was an issue either, but you can speak with her further. Regarding the loop, naming a building, naming the school, I feel like I have to dance around that. That's an issue that the Sebastian Charter Board has to decide. My original idea of naming a building after Dr. McAdams was half agreed to by the board and half disagreed to. They had other plans in mind. The loop is still part of the school. If you follow the recommendation of Mr. Griffin, perhaps what you could do is formulate a letter that makes that recommendation, several of them, whether it be a building, whether it be the building, the school, or the loop after Dr. McAdams, and it comes from the city council, perhaps it carries weight. I, as a civics teacher, it doesn't carry a lot of weight. And I was on the board for 8 years. And I took the civics job for 2 weeks. It was 3 years now. So I leave it in your hands to decide. My homework hopefully will help you in deciding about the street name. I learned a lot more than I expected, and I'm very pleased with what I learned. And I hope you ask Mr. Griffin to continue that direction. Independent of that, if you wish to formulate a letter to the Sebastian Charter Board with your desires, I'd go with it as well. Doesn't mean you can't do both.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Engel.
You're welcome.
Anybody have any questions for Ms. Lingway?
Just a comment. I would even, if that's our decision to go with the loop, I would even be willing to call all the board members personally, some of which I may already know, to encourage that in addition to a letter. I want Dr. McAdams' name there somewhere, somehow, some way. I would rather have it be the road, but it's, I don't know. I'm.
Ms. Mayor?
Yes, sir.
I could. I want to just thank Mr. Ingwe for you know, the clarity that he's given us with this going on the police department. My big concern was the first responders, and it seems like there won't be a problem. If Wave Street was huge, I would also have another issue with renaming it if, you know, if there's going to be other folks on there. But they're basically the only people, they're the only entity on Wave Street right now. You know, I'm comfortable renaming the street. I would make a motion that we go ahead with the first option and rename Wave Street to Martha McAdams Way.
I'm going to second that.
Anyone from the public wish to speak on this matter, the name change? Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Ben Hawker, Sebastian. Where I came from, anything pertaining with the schools, with the knowledge, the people that were there, they renamed the school. Didn't rename the streets, didn't go about all of this, looking at whether we can do this or that. The U-turn is the school's property. If they want to name it anything they want, they could feel free to do that. It's not a public street. Now they want to change a public street because this man did great things. Well, I didn't do too many great things.
It's a woman.
Well, a woman, whatever. I didn't do too many great things, but I've got... Well, we have separate and singular bathrooms, too, so... stuff that I designed is sitting on the moon. This is an educator. I was a design engineer. How do I petition the city to have the street I live on turned over and get signatures from the residents and rename it Benny Lane? How do I get Main Street renamed to the council member lane for all of the past council members that have we're honoring with the road? Seems like we're going down something here. A change on the school, a plaque in the school, but we're disturbing the whole system of the city. If we change a name for one with a logical reason, and maybe mine was a logical reason. I wouldn't really want a name after me, but I'm saying we could have street changes coming from all over the city here. We could have Hiram's Way on Indian River Drive because of what he's done for the community. We could have many things that way. I don't think the road change as a honor to someone is the way to really go with this. Thank you.
All right, thank you, sir. Anyone else from the public wish to speak on the name change? Yeah, I guess my point is if it was so important to change the name of the street, and I'm not downplaying Dr. McAdams' role in any way, shape, or form, I would think that the board kind of would be in, you know, agreement in this and come to us about changing the street name to Dr. McAdams' Way, but they can't even agree on changing the loop. And like I had said at the last meeting, and again, I know the contribution she has made with the charter school over there. I was like, why don't they just name the building after her? And they were the school after her, and they couldn't even come to agreement in naming a building after her. They named a room after her, I believe was what it was. And again, we're looking at, it's like, you know, still they would need our approval for the loop, but it's okay if we go change the street name. And they haven't come before us, and they're in agreement for a street name change. So I'm not in agreement for changing the name of the street, because the problems, yes, it might be in agreement where they're updating these maps right now, But I guess the Google car was driving around Vero Beach, driverless, and probably mapping out the city, and I don't think that's going to be coming around again. So it wouldn't necessarily be on their map as McAdams Way. It would still be as Wave Street.
And I want to clarify that, and I don't know if the motion needs to be tweaked, but this would be, the motion would be if it is to continue on with the formal change, it still has to come before you as a resolution and a formal application. So this isn't necessarily the decision to rename the street, but I don't know if you needed to amend your motion to have them bring in an application to continue on with the formal renaming of the street. And we can require then, if you want, on that application, that that would need to come from the school itself, or if you're okay with it just coming from Mr. Ingwe as a representative of the school. If that helps with Mr. McPartland's concerns that this is an actual request
sure.
from the board as a whole.
And I would change my, I would amend my motion to that, that we would have to have, you know, obviously board approval for this change. And I assume that Mr. Ingwe was speaking for the board when he came to request that. Sir?
Just to clarify in terms of the board, signatures on the petition include two members of the Sebastian Charter Board. One of them is sitting there. And one of them is a signature from Mr. Sean Frost from the Indian River County School Board. So those are part of my signatures that I turned over to Mr. Griffin.
Okay.
How many members on the board?
There are four, I believe, at this time, and there were two who signed off on the idea.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
So, I mean, if that helps, it would have to come back to us anyway.
Yes, and Mr. Ingwe can attach that petition or any other letter that he'd like to with that application that will be brought to you as support of the request
okay.
and the application.
He turned in a petition at the last.
Okay, we'll get it and then attach it to the application, make it part of the formal application.
Well, you make a really good point.
Any further discussion on it?
You were going to, Mr. Gilmore, you were going to amend your motion?
Yes, I would amend it to the fact that we would need to get a unanimous request from the board to do that.
Or a majority.
Or a majority, well.
Majority.
Not unanimous, but majority of the board members, which I guess would be three if there's four. But I was under the impression that the board was in favor of it when I made the motion.
Well, and there's no guarantee that it would go through. It would come back to council. I could buy off on that, and I'll amend my second to match that. The board has to submit the application. So.
Motion
it's not a done deal. It's still.
I still don't, I'm just confused. Well, not confused, but again, and I'm not, she's made a lot of great contributions, and I would like to see that the board steps up. This is their person who has been there for 14 years, you know, started this school, got it, there was a building there, but she created the school and got it built. And now they can't go forward and do any more than name a room for her. But we're going to rename the street, and they're not, you know, in line with that. So, I mean, it just doesn't make any sense to me that they can't do their part, but they want the city to do this. You know, and it goes back to kind of Mr. Hocker's statements. Then, you know, anybody else comes along and says, hey, we want to change this street, you know, something along those lines, so.
Yeah, and I know that I'm leaning towards this because I have interacted with Dr. McAdams on many, 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 many occasions and seen the work at the school. So I believe in what she has done. I know what she's done and how important she's been to getting that school built. So I am prejudiced on this. I have seen it with my own eyes, what she has done, and been in that school on many occasions. And I don't even have kids.
Right. As have I. You know, and I'm willing to write a strongly worded letter that, you know, anything along the lines to rename the loop or even, you know, say, hey, advocate on our behalf for naming the school after her or one of the new buildings that they have there or a wing.
Okay.
But, you know, changing the name is, of a street is, it's a big thing. And as Mr. Griffin had noted about the situation that happened out of the golf course, you know, a few years ago, that's a very real situation. And all the accidents that may happen on Wave Street don't necessarily happen at the school. It could be just on a portion of Wave Street. And they're saying, you know, when it gets lost in confusion sometimes. So, any other comments?
Mm-mm.
Roll call, Ms. Williams.
Ms. Coy?
No.
Mr. Gilmore?
Yes.
Mayor McPartlin?
No.
Motion fails.
All right. Brings us up to item 12B, award the Barber Street reconstruction contract to Tim Rose Contracting. Mr. Griffin.
Yes, sir. We published a public bid for the Barber Street reconstruction. Originally, the Barber Street reconstruction spec was for from County Road 512 northbound to the Hardy Bridge. That bid came in with one taker, Tim Rose Construction, and that bid was severely over budget to the tune of about $691,000 and change. We had one bidder, as I say, Tim Rose Contracting, went to Mr. Rose, negotiated with him, and decided that if we knocked off 1,000 feet from that reconstruction, made it from County Road 512 to Salem, that we could knock the cost down to $478,118.50. We came to an agreement contingent on council approval, and we bring that forward tonight recommending approval.
Right. Council, any questions for Mr. Griffin?
Yes, I have one question.
Yes, sir.
Was Tim Rose not the same company that did Fleming?
Yes,
and
correct.
Maine?
Yes.
What was the cost of Fleming and the cost of Maine? Do you have those?
I have no idea. I can't remember. Frank,
do you? Yeah, I think, sorry about that. Roughly, Frank Watanabe, the city engineer, Fleming Street was about 300 something. Main Street was about the same price, but it started off, we thought, was just going to be an overlay, and it became out to be more a reconstruction project, so that's what we had to move more money into the project. So I think the total.
Yeah, recall that. Do you know what the total cost was?
Both of those within the $300,000 range, you know, between $300,000 to $400,000 each one, and so Barber Street still falls within that same range of prices in terms of. To add on to the city manager's comment, the original price also included parts of Ocel between Roseland Road to Barber Street. I actually broke it into three components. I took Barber Street from 512 to Ocel, then from Ocel to the bridge, and then a third piece was Ocel to see if I could do within that price range, and mm-hmm. it was way over the price range.
Yeah. Okay. So it's about the same price per linear foot, or?
The actual asphalt tonnage, you're correct. It's still within the same price range.
Okay.
But this is a reconstruction, whereas Fleming was not all reconstruction. Maine was reconstruction.
Yeah, the difference in this reconstruction, it may be slightly cheaper and is a longer stretch, is because Fleming, we had to do that cement-treated base, which they call a full-dip reclamation, where they have to tear it all out, pour in concrete, mix it together, then put in a whole new base. We did the same thing with Main Street. This is just to put coquina rock, we'll rip it out, we'll put coquina rock as a base, and then we'll AC it. And so it is a reconstruction, but a different type of reconstruction, not using that cement-treated base.
Well, Maine was done in sections. There was just pieces that it was reconstructed. It wasn't all.
That's correct. Yes.
That's all I had, Mayor.
On page 78, that's the final bid, right? That's.
Yes, ma'am.
That's okay. So we took Vosell out of the loop.
Took Vosell out, and you see the 3,300 linear feet from County Road 512 to Vosell, and then Vosell to Salem up Barber.
Okay. So that's page 78 is the final, because
78 yeah, is the okay. revised
Got
bid.
It. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
And the numbers How come 2 inches of asphalt on Barber Street costs $88.50, but on Vosell and Salem it costs $91.60?
Again, that's the contractors. You know, it depends on how he has to take care of some of the driveways, the number of cross streets. There's a variety of reasons why he changes his dollar amount on a bid item. Ranger, we just finished a milling and resurfacing Ranger. His numbers across the board. It was all within the same between $85 to $95, but each street was slightly different. And it didn't make any sense sometimes why they just round it up. But you know, they do that to do the bids.
Interesting. So if we looked at Ranger, it would be the same. And said Ranger's contract would be.
Just for the asphalt, the Ranger contract was a milling and overlay. But if you just take a look at the asphalt price itself, the tonnage.
Yeah, but there would be a different price. It could be different prices.
But the asphalt is asphalt. You're right. Why the tonnage is not the same, it's surprising why it is not.
Okay. That's all I have.
No other questions? All right. Can I get a motion for award?
I'll make a motion that we approve it.
Second. Anyone from the public wish to speak on the Barber Street reconstruction contract? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Linda Kinchin. I live at 190 Delmar Street, Sebastian. I just have some concerns. We took 1,000 linear feet out from Vosell Avenue to Salem, but yet the sod price stays the same. So, you know, where's that 1,000 feet of sod going to go? And on item one, the MOT, he's not going to remove his equipment and mobilize over again, so why is the MOT on the second section so high? Ranger did 5 streets that are not contiguous, and their total price was $244,000. They had to mobilize on each different street. So I just think you need to look at that a little bit closer.
Thank you, ma'am. Anyone else wish to speak on this? Yes, sir.
Did they do anything? Russell and Sebastian. When is this project supposed to start if it gets approved?
Looking at.
Hopefully, we'll deliver the notice to proceed within 14 days of council approval.
And you're going to go from 512 to Salem Street with this project. Now, you knowing Barber Street's going to be a very active street.
It always is.
I know. Right. What are we going to do about traffic going down that road and people getting to their houses?
Need to direct
questions
to the chair.
Well, I mean, I'm sure it's just like paving any other street. And then you look at the time of the year, the school's not in session, so there is a little less traffic. It's got to be done. I'm sure there will be notices made and detours along the way. Is that right, Mr. Watanabe?
That is correct. We will stage it out. We just finished the paving on Schumann. Schumann is one of the most critical roads into from the US-1. We did have support from the PD. Carlin was there, but you know, we had to close the road. We staged it, and we still allowed traffic to come in and out. They did half a road at a time, so there is ways to stage the road.
All right. Thank you. Any other questions?
No, that's all right. That's fine.
Thank you.
Just wanted to know.
Anyone else want to speak about the Barber Street reconstruction? Seeing none. All right, any further discussion? All right. Any other summation, Mr. Griffin?
I would just say that council's been pretty adamant about their desire to see us get going on road construction. And we realize that there's going to be a disruption from time to time, and people getting around town. We apologize for that. But it's necessary evil. We have to proceed. And actually, we plan on being a little bit more aggressive with our road reconstruction and repaving in the next fiscal year.
Now I do have a comment. Okay. On top of what was just said. My greatest concern, and we have talked a little bit about this, because this is not the only contract that this gentleman has with our city, I'm concerned that things might get backed up or turn into a longer project than anticipated. And so I know we were in a bind on this and not having, is this the one that didn't have any, no other bids, right? There was, nobody else came to bid on this. I don't get it, but that's, you know, it's not that we didn't do what we were supposed to do. It was advertised appropriately. But I'm just concerned because there is another item here that's going to be contracted out, and I'm concerned that this one contractor may not be prepared to fulfill these contracts in a timely manner. So I don't know what we can do about that at this point, other than go back to, well, we can't even go back to scratch because it's not something that was in the original process.
This is a concern of mine. I agree with you 100%. I've talked to members of staff about that. As a matter of fact, one of the first assignments I gave our new contracts administrator, Jim Romanek, was to research what other municipalities do in this regard when they only have one contractor handling multiple contracts. We have nothing in our policy or procedures to direct that on us. So it's not that we're shooting from the hip, but we're trying and we want to keep the pressure on the contractor to move the project along, but and we only have one bidder here in this example, what's equitable for everybody? Jim did some research on this, and lo and behold, no one has a real policy on this. No one in our local area, Vero Beach, Indian River County. So I think from now on, and you're going to see another item right after this item, is Tim Rose Contracting. So he's going to have a number of projects all at once. He's going to have a lot of balls in the air. It's going to be up to us to manage this to keep these projects moving forward. I certainly want these projects completed before the end of the summer. The big critical one is the CAVCOR project, obviously, after the 4th of July. That's due to start. Obviously, I have to have that finished before Clambake.
Right.
So the pressure is going to be on him to perform. He has done, I would say, a very good job in the contracts that he's been let here in the past couple years. Presidential Streets, Barber Street Bridge, Fleming, Maine, some other projects. So I've been satisfied. I think Frank and his inspection team has been satisfied. So we'll try to manage this as best we can and move these projects along.
Okay.
Any other questions?
No. Just a comment. I think Barber Street really does need it. You know, when it rains, you can see that the base is, you know, taking some of that water. And the other part of Barber was paved how many years ago? I mean, it's been 6-7 years since we paved the other part of Barber. So it's long overdue. So I think we've been pretty satisfied with what the work that they did on Fleming. And I know it took a while for Main Street to finally get done, but that was because of some of the rain that we had, and the people that are on Main Street love the work that's been done. So I mean, they did a good job. So I'm happy to support this.
Right. I guess the only other wrinkle I would throw in there was, once they do the reconstruction, will they blade the grass on both sides? I brought that up to you earlier today about they repaved there on Benedictine, but the grass is higher than the road on both sides. And I mean, we're spending $433,000, and you know, if the water still stands on the road and can't get off the road, it doesn't.
Yeah, to answer your questions on these overlays, even on the reconstruct projects, I would love to raise the road. However, the problem then is all the driveways. We had the problem, that's what we had with Fleming Street. I was smart, wasn't too smart, where I raised it slightly, and then we had huge projects tying into all the driveways. So that increased that cost slightly. So we're trying to hold ground and try to match what we have as best as possible. But you're right. If the best of all worlds, we would love to raise that road a slight few inches, but we didn't because we had to hold all the driveways.
Right. Well, I know raising would cost more money. I'm talking blading the grass like we have discussed in the past, and that way the water gets off the road.
We don't have that. We don't have stuff with the blade yet.
We do. Yes, ma'am. Yes, we do. We have a grader at the airport, and I remember when I made the presentation about the quarter round and back in the fall, and we talked about that. My promise to you when we were going to use that quarter round money to buy the new Abercrombie, and then, pardon me?
The second Armadillo hasn't shown up yet.
That's Armadillo, sorry. And then we were going to have a crew that would going back of that crew with the blade and things like that. We still plan on doing that, but I'll get Tim to look at. I'll get Tim to look at the Tim Walker, our public works guy, to look at the Benedictine, especially tomorrow. I'll take a ride out there with him.
All right. Thank you, Joe. All right. We have a motion and a second. Roll call, Ms. Williams.
Ms. Coy.
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore.
Yes.
Mayor McPartland.
Yes.
Motion passes.
All right. All right. We move public input down below, so it brings us up to item 14, new business. Item A, award the working waterfront drainage improvements contract to Tim Rose Contracting. Mr. Griffin.
This is exactly what I was talking about before, that we put out a public bid on this working waterfront drainage. We got three bids. Tim Rose Contracting, $77,335 and change. And the next one, next highest, was $171,000 and change. Huge variance. So Frank and I, frankly, were scratching our heads about this, and we figured, well, there's a mobilization cost, the economies that he's going to have, but almost $100,000. But he was a low bidder, so we're bringing this forward and recommending approval.
All right. Any questions for staff, council?
Nope.
Get a motion?
Move approval. Second.
Second. All right. Anyone from the public wish to speak on this item? Yes, sir.
Ben Hocker, City of Sebastian. With the CAVCOR bid, we put in parking spaces. We piggybacked it onto going on Indian River Drive. There was also a comment in that bid on redoing some of the water drainage or drainage at the working waterfront. And that particular bid, I believe, had all three items in it. I might be wrong. I didn't see the final result of the bid. But I'm looking at that property up there, and I see a swale that runs around the perimeter of the parking lots where we put a pipe underground and made it access for properties on US 1. We've also prior authorized a sewer line to be run down through city property. What I've gone by there, I haven't run into major puddles, major problems. We just put some form of blacktop on the parking lot in the working waterfront for the commercial fishermen. I don't know, I didn't look around enough. It might have been a bid, might not have been a bid. I don't know how it was done. But again, you're going for drainage improvements, but you're taking funding out of that for the bulkhead and putting it into a contract that's been let. Didn't we put shrubbery and what have you in the bid for CAVCOR, and now we're trying to take money from elsewhere? And I don't understand the draining issue. Maybe somebody can explain it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir. Got any answers there, Mr. Griffin?
There was a couple conflicting things there, but this project, this is a standalone project, and we've got FDOT and DEP grants for this. We got two grants for this project, correct? Along with city match, which was $24,000.
We actually, you're correct. We have a DEP, a TMDL, which is a total maximum load demand grant to the state. And then we also have a St. John's cost sharing grant. And what I did was to hope, and it worked out, was to submit both grants and use each other as our local match, which they allowed us to do. And we got both grants, so we have two grants paying for our project. The project is another a water quality project where we're going to install a baffle box. This one's going to go beyond that, and we're going to install what they call a treatment train, where we're going to install some flock blocks and some other devices to help improve that outflow. So it is another water quality with a baffle box.
I think one of the things that Mr. Hocker was talking about was he talked about the CAVCOR project. There are three projects on that one contract with Mr. Rose. CAVCOR parking lot itself, the angle parking along on Indian River Drive at the dialysis center just north of Earl's, and, oh, the cop parking, the cop shop parking, straight-in parking off of Main Street. So maybe he was a little confused about that drainage thing. There is some pipe work and drainage box work that city staff is going to do at the CAVCOR project along with a large retention area. Isn't that correct?
That's correct.
At the CAVCOR. That's all I got.
Thank you. All right. Sounds good to me. Any further council discussion? All right, roll call, Ms. Williams.
Mr. Gilmore.
Yes.
Mayor McPartlin.
Yes.
Ms. Coy.
Yes.
Motion carries.
All right. That passes. We accept item 14B, resolution number R-16-14, FDOT joint participation agreement for taxiway improvements. Mr. Griffin.
Yes, sir. As I said in the agenda transmittal, we have for years been petitioning, lobbying FDOT, FAA about the inadequacy of the taxiway system at Sebastian Airport. Sebastian Airport, as you know, is a non-towered field. Because of that status, pilots are responsible for their own separation on the ground and in the air. In the air, really, we provide NOTAMs, notice to airmen. We provide flight procedures. On the ground, we provide signage. And we also have a automated radio traffic system that pilots can listen to. But really, what will add to the safety of things is trying to do something about the taxiway system itself while people are on the ground taxiing around. Towards that end, Scott has been petitioning FDOT to do something about that and did in fact receive a grant. This is for design and engineering of three new taxiways at the airport. This JPA is for taxiway C, D, and E. We would anticipate that in a couple weeks we are going to receive the FAA portion of this design commitment, which is going to be $277,000 and change. This JPA from FDOT is for $13,800 and change. Our match on this is also $13,800 and change, so we are recommending approval.
Thank Move you. Approval of R-16-14 FDOT Joint Participation Agreement.
Second. Anyone from the public wish to speak on this? Roll call, Ms. Williams.
Mayor McPartlin.
Yes.
Ms. Coy.
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore.
Yes.
Motion carries.
All right, very good. Leads us up to item 14C, consider local preference bid status. Mr. Griffin.
Yes, sir. At the last meeting, I believe it was Councilmember Coy was talking about local preference bid status. And I said that I would bring back at the next meeting a review of this and to consider if we want to amend this or continue. I included the two ordinances that controlled that. One was provided for a 3% reduce of the bid that was prior to 2009. And the one that's in effect right now is a 5%. And it applies to businesses in City of Sebastian, Indian River County, St. Lucie, Martin, Okeechobee, and Osceola County, and or Brevard County. So I brought this forward for your discussion and consideration, and stand by for your instructions.
All right. Council?
I mostly have a problem with the extension of how far we go and call it local. And I know at the time we did this, we did discuss that. And it was, I think there's some other organizations that consider the regional aspect of things and tying into regions, yada, yada, yada. So I kind of would like to narrow our local focus to Indian River County. That to me is local. I don't know.
I don't know. Yeah, I agree. I think that this might be a tool that we could use for economic development for Indian River County. Anybody moving a business here or coming here can see that we have a local preference. And the way it stands now, they can be in Osceola County, or they can be in Brevard, or they can be in St. Lucie, or they can be in Martin. You know, they can be close to 100, well, yeah, they can be 100 miles away and still be considered local. And for us, I think, to do any good from an economic standpoint, economic development standpoint, you know, by giving our local folks a crack at contracts that we're letting, as long as they match the five, you know, they're within 5% of the bid and they match the low bid, then we're protecting the city, and we're also, you know, making sure that that money stays in Indian River County, and there's a good chance the folks will live maybe in our city. So I think I would be in favor of narrowing it, as Councilwoman Coy said, to just Indian River County, leaving it pretty much the same, except saying local preferences Indian River County.
I would like, you know, I didn't have a chance to ask the city manager what his particular feeling on this was. So I guess I would like to ask him one way or the other. How will this adversely affect business?
No, I think it would enhance things. And also, we saw a prime example here twice tonight where we only had one bid for a job, and maybe this would help with, you know, getting more bids in here. I did hear two things, though. I heard it would kind of be a combination of the local vendor preference would be to a business from the city of Sebastian, Indian River County, excuse me, and then with the other ordinance, it'd be a 5%. They could take, if they're within 5%, they would have an opportunity to match the low bid. Did I read that right? Is that
yes.
What I?
Mm-hmm.
So it would kind of be a combination of the two ordinances. Is that correct, Bob? Is that how you say it?
Yes. The procedure for notifying bidders and for offering the opportunity to lower would remain the same.
But it would be Indian River County only.
Correct.
Correct.
And 5%, not the 3% that was in the ordinance
right.
prior to 2009.
Right.
Correct?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I would go for the 5% too. Yep.
But see, my concern is if we just say Indian River County, we're only a good golf drive away from Brevard County. Now, if they change their laws up there that they were only going to seek Brevard County people, that might knock some of our people out that are right, because we border Brevard County. I could see knocking off St. Lucie or Martin County and Osceola County, but Brevard is, they're our neighbor. I mean, right close.
That's a very good point. And that was part of, now it's coming back, that was part of the argument. We expanded it because of the neighbors, and I could probably buy off on that, extending it. Then Brevard is a long, long.
It's county. 75 miles long. So I mean, you from here, nice. You're 80 miles. You can be in Brevard and be almost in Daytona Beach. So I don't honestly. I don't think that I really don't think that Brevard is going to change their, you know, their county policy just because little old Sebastian changes their. You know, I don't see that happening.
I don't know what their policy is.
Can't say
if
I do
either. Or if they have one, but I'm not discounting your point, because I don't want it to hurt our vendors. How about a mile radius?
Could do that. 25-mile radius?
30?
Is that
30's fine with me.
Is that sufficient? We could do 30 miles from City Hall?
Trouble, well, does that include all of Indian River County? Let me just mention that.
All of Indian River County and 30 miles from City Hall. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
30 miles from...
We got problems. The attorney's not liking this.
I guess we could have a map and draw the circle around City Hall. I believe that all of this is a policy matter for the board, for the council.
That's just more incentive for Brevard County guys to give us good low bids. I mean, if they know it ahead of time that our folks are going to be given preference, they write a low bid.
So I guess one of the things I look at, Palm Bay is always growing. And then they might, they heard it. Sebastian is not having anybody from Brevard County. They may look, we might lose out some of our businesses, doing business up there.
Well, they would have to be, they did the same thing, I mean, what's the chances of them having bids within 5%? I mean, the chances, flip a coin, but I mean, it's minuscule. I don't think we've used this buy local. I don't think that there's maybe only been one time when this buy local ordinance actually would benefit anybody, and that was a firm in Palm Bay or Melbourne, and the fellow actually lived in Sebastian, the general manager lived in Sebastian. It was for a pavilion that was going to go into Riverview Park, and we had to rebid the whole thing because it was done incorrectly. The local bidder was within the 5%. They were not given a chance to match, and we had to rebid the whole thing again because we had said we were going to give a contract to somebody that was in, do you remember that?
Mm-hmm.
They were in
playground?
No, I think it was the pavilion.
And then we didn't approve the pavilion.
Then we didn't. This has only come into, it's only, this is not something that is going to really, but I do think that we ought to give our local Indian River folks a shot, and as far as anybody affecting, I just don't see it happening. And we may never have anybody that's within 5%, but if we do, I think it would give staff a little bit more of an option, because they wouldn't just have to take the lowest bidder. They could say, well, let's look at this and say, hey, we have somebody that's, bid this out from Vero Beach. They're within 5%. Let's see if we can get them to match the bid. And now you've got two companies you can choose from. And you give the local guy, I'd like to see the local guy get the bid.
I would too. I would really like to see our Sebastian. And we're talking probably small items. We're not talking about road paving a lot, because we don't have the big companies here.
Yeah.
Talking about things like pest control and contracts for landscaping and the smaller contracts.
And sheds and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
So I don't feel, I think we, it may or may not be an incentive, but if it even brought one business, a small business into town, I think it would be worth it for them to say, well, hey, They want to give us business there, and so we want to write a good bid.
Well, and I think also it's a public relations thing. We can go out to the business community and say, look, we have a buy local ordinance that we put some teeth in, and so please look for our bids, because if you come within 5% of the low bid, you're going to get a shot at it. So I think it really gives us an incentive to reach out to the local business community and say, we're looking out for you. So.
All right, so you want to make it Indian River County and
5%.
5%.
Yeah.
Okay, you want to make a motion 5%. Out of that?
So moved.
All right.
Second.
All right, any public input on this matter? All right, roll call, Ms. Williams.
Mayor McPartlin.
Yes.
Ms. Coy.
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore.
Yes.
Motion carries.
All right, very good. Brings us up to item 14D, first reading of ordinance number O-18-03. Mr. Ginsburg?
Well, actually, it's O-1603. This is one of the charter amendment proposals that you approved last time to prepare an ordinance. The title is an ordinance of the City of Sebastian, Indian River County, Florida, scheduling an election to be held on Tuesday, November 8th, 2016, for the purpose of submitting to the electors of the City of Sebastian the question of whether to amend Section 203 and Section 4.12A of the City Charter by conducting elections in even-numbered years and providing four-year terms for City Council members, providing ballot language and an effective date. This is first reading.
Council, what's your pleasure with this?
Move approval.
Second. Anyone from the public wish to speak on the first reading of this charter amendment? Yes, sir.
Ben Hocker, City of Sebastian. By doing this, we're going into a situation that was rejected by the public at a prior vote that was put before us. Now, what I read in here is that it's about a $38,000 election fee which we'd be saving. Well, that's peanuts. I mean, we have a wind turbine that failed. That's well over $100,000. We're talking here a four-year term with no change. And I look up here at the dais now, I see an excused absence multiple times. I don't know what that relates to in this. I know if I don't show up as a council member and don't tell anyone, three times and I'm out. But we've got a situation here that we're changing two people every 2 years. And we're changing three people the following 2 years. Now, by coming in here with a four-year term, do we have any limitations that we can put on this in term that can be served, making it a two-term, four-year? After 8 years in the position, you cannot rerun again until 4 years pass. I mean, we've got something here that we've got people that could be making a life career out of this by going every 4 years. And I'm not referring to the present board, but it just seems kind of odd that we've got a thing working, people rejected this prior. I also heard a couple comments during the meeting that, well, let's give it a try. There wasn't that big a voter turnout. Maybe we can get it passed through this time because there'll be a bigger turnout. I just totally disagree with a four-year term unless we can have some restrictions of a two-term limit. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir. Anyone else from the public wish to speak on this charter amendment change? All right. Any further council discussion on this matter?
No.
I just want to say that I have reservations on this without some type of meaningful term limits. I can't go along with it. So.
All right. Well, I guess one of the things I looked at is term limits. Every time there's an election, they vote you in, they vote you out. It's kind of it. And I know I was on the Charter Review Committee 5 years ago when we put this forward, and it did fail on the ballot. But then again, the Charter Review Committee that met this past time for however many meetings over several months, they felt strongly about putting this back on the ballot, and one of the reasons was the lower voter turnout. So we had agreed to, you know, put this forward. So, a motion and a second. Roll call, Ms. Williams.
Ms. Coy.
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore?
No.
Mayor McPartlin?
Yes.
And just, Mr. Mayor, for clarification, I'd like to ask the city attorney, that just means the motion has failed. This will be back
for first reading at the next meeting. Is that correct?
Correct.
Because there are only three of us seated up here. One person cannot have that kind of power to say no. It usually takes two people. It takes three people to say yes. All of us have to say yes to make something go forward. You'd like to think this could go forward, but nothing happens because our charter says we have to have three vote yes. I'm not making this up. That's the deal. So technically, the motion failed, but it doesn't mean, because I clarified this beforehand, knowing that there are only going to be three of us sitting here tonight, I didn't think it's right that one person could stop an item and then it be removed and not come back. So this will be back next meeting as the first reading.
So July 13th.
Correct.
Correct?
Right. But it will still be the first reading,
the
correct?
The first reading.
Correct.
Correct.
All right. Very good. I had kept hearing that three vote yes. I was just thinking of three blind mice in my head, but I can let that voice go. So that brings us up to item 14E, the first reading of ordinance number O dash, is it O or zero?
O.
O.
For
okay.
Ordinance.
O dash 16-04, charter amendment, amend section 2.05. Mr. Ginsburg.
Yes, sir. This item, the title is an ordinance of the City of Sebastian, Indian River County, Florida, scheduling an election to be held on Tuesday, November 8th, 2016, for the purpose of submitting to the electors of the City of Sebastian the question of whether to amend section 205 of the City Charter by increasing the compensation for the mayor, vice mayor, and city council members, and by requiring that any payments for expenses be limited to reimbursement of actual expenses incurred, providing ballot language and an effective date. First reading.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Ginsburg. Counselor, what's your pleasure on this item here?
Move approval of O-16-04.
Second.
Anyone from the public wish to speak on this item? Yes, sir.
Ben Hawker, Sebastian. What I see here is that in our charter, we have a salary of 300 and 350, depending on your position. We then had what was called a stipend, which was $300 for each council member. Now, that was just another way of saying it's a salary. There was also a $300 expense limit. In reading this, you're eliminating the stipend, which means now you're putting $700 or $750, depending on a position, into a taxable, et cetera, item. And then we had a $300 expense account.
That's not true.
Which was a limit.
It was all being taxed as if it was income for us. But
I'm talking about the expense account now.
Right, that's going to be gone.
Well, requiring any payments for expenses be limited to reimbursement of actual expenses incurred. That's an expense account. So if I go to a meeting and I fill up my car and it's a dinner meeting and I had to pay $100 to go into this particular meeting, I put it on an expense account. Now it can be $1 for that or it could be $1,000. Where is the limit to the expense account requirements? And I don't see that in here. So it could be unlimited. Maybe there's a meeting down in Miami. Well, I'll put it on my expense account. The city picks up the hotel, the motel room, but everything else, I'll write up on my expense account. And it might not be a $200 expense account. It could be an unlimited expense account. It's kind of vague in that area. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir. Yes, Mr. Griffin, my question for you would be actual expenses incurred. I'm sure there's a limit whenever you travel around, what kind of accommodations you can have and how much you could be reimbursed for a meal.
There is a limit And it's also public access to view what those expenses are. We send policemen off to school all the time, other issues. I've got the airport manager going to a Florida Airports Council convention next month. All these things are vetted with the city manager, and once those expenses come back and the checks are given to the employee, obviously it's all public record, and anybody can view it. So if somebody wants to see what somebody spent at the Marriott, they're going to see it.
Right. Well, I guess what my question is, when I go away for the state, there's a limit. You know, I say I'm gone for the day or whatever, my breakfast, they'll only reimburse up to, say, like $7, $12.50, I think, for lunch, and like $20 for dinner. I can't submit a bill that I had a $100 steak and four bottles of wine, and that gets reimbursed. Is that similar here in the city?
I see what you're saying. Everything except the wine.
Right, so. Except the wine. But I mean, again, that would be transparent in all of those records with the receipts. I couldn't say that I had a $100 steak and just write down $100. I would have to have the
verifiable
tax receipt, and I would hope that the city manager would be questioning $100 meals that anybody was having.
There's limits, and our finance department looks at that.
Okay.
And there, I mean, I see Mr. Hawker's concern. There would be some room for abuse of this system, but sooner or later, it's going to catch up in the budget, and alarm bells are going to go off that, hey, we're running out of money, budgeted money, for, and I think it's appropriate that we monitor each other. No one can just go out and have a $100 dinner without some kind of approval, I'm assuming. You know, you just can't go do that.
Right.
We get invitations all the time to these grand events. Personally, I can't go because, one, I have nothing to wear, and two, that's just out of my budget. So I would think that something like that has to be approved ahead of time, that Mr. Kilgore, someone's going to have to say, yeah, Andrea, go ahead to this one, yada, 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 and bring the receipt and we'll reimburse you. I can tell you, I'd have a hard time justifying that to the public and looking people in the eye that was a legitimate expense. There are some people who have no problem abusing the system, but they get caught by people like Ben, who will go in and ask to look at the finances, and others. So there are checks and balances on all of this.
Right.
It's not unlimited.
So, I mean, he also brings up a good point about if I go to a meeting, just like I go to the MPO meeting, now can I claim mileage? I mean, not that I would, but I'm just saying, is that possible, or maybe something, if this goes through, needs to be changed around for that? Because, I mean, the other aspect is I know when I was in the military, I used to do some temporary duty stations. They would pay for my dry cleaning. I could claim that I left $3 for the maid to turn down my bed. And I'm just saying, these just bring up points, and you wouldn't necessarily need a receipt for those items. Or I got my laundry done, but it was all my laundry, not just what I had from that trip.
The maid?
Hmm?
Really?
The maid, yeah. They used to say you could leave her $2 a day or whatever, and that was back in the 80s.
So, I had to account for every penny, and I went on a lot of TDY trips. So, I mean, I'm used to receipts. I'm used to,
right.
So. And I mean, even now, when I go to Florida League of Cities, I bring back the dollar and $1.50 on the turnpike to get to Orlando, or on the B line. I bring back each and every receipt, each and every time. That's normal procedure to document. I think we are setting it up for a little bit of abuse here, but I also believe that other people, you get caught. You haven't read about the high spenders in the county? Come on, it's been in the paper.
Well, as it is right now, we don't get reimbursed for mileage. So when you go to, we only if it's over 75 miles. So every League of Cities meeting I go to is within 75 miles. So I don't get reimbursed for that. I would assume that after this, if this passes, that since they're taking away the account, that you would be reimbursed for that. I know Felsmere reimburses Mayor Tyson every time he drives to a meeting, whether it be on the beach or whether it's beach and shore or whether it's wherever, he gets reimbursed.
Right.
So I would, and that's so much a mile. I think it's 53 cents or 56 cents, whatever it is a mile. You know.
But then we could also claim mileage. I go back and forth to my house just hitting this meeting tonight.
Yeah, mile
but then
and
I
half.
Guess, again, that's the transparency where you have to turn all this in. I have to fill out the forms that I did 6.3 miles coming here back and forth to the meeting, and then that would be on the public being the watchdog to say, hey, look, you're being a little bit ridiculous here. Or if we have one council member up here who is turning in expenses for $300 a month and nobody else is. You know?
I think we need to hold, we do have something that limits us in the driving that it's at 75 miles. If it's over X number of miles, we don't get reimbursed at all. I don't intend to turn around and get reimbursed for my trip to Vero Beach. I think that's ridiculous. But that's me, and that's my values on what's required. I would think that, though, if I had to go to a meeting that was in Fort Lauderdale, and it was a mandatory meeting or something that council sent me to, not something that Andrea just wanted to go to because it was a nice thing to do, but if it was a directed activity, yes, I'd get reimbursed for mileage and meals at the standard rate. I don't see this changing. But I'm glad we're clarifying this because I don't think anyone should be reimbursed nickel and dime. I think that's abuse of a system. You need to get a job, a real job.
All right. Any other discussion on this? All right. Ms. Williams, roll call, please.
Ms. Coy.
I forgot what's the motion?
Motion is to approve agenda item 14E.
Thank you. I made that motion, too. Yes.
Okay. Mr. Gilmore?
Yes.
Mayor McPartland?
Yes.
Motion carries.
All right.
Before we leave the item, can we schedule the second reading of this item on the 13th, or do you want to wait on that?
No, that's I'd like it to go.
13th of July.
I guess we could maybe do it for the next one because we got to wait for the other one's going to be the first reading, and then they could both have their second readings at the same time.
I leave that to you to tell us.
Right?
You tell us.
Does that make more sense to you?
I'd like to knock it out. If we have a complement of people, let's get rid of the ones. There may be some additions at the next meeting,
okay.
Too.
All right. But at 13th.
Want to make this second reading on the 13th of July for this one.
Yes,
you'll have
sir.
First reading of 14D also.
Right. All right. Thank you, Mr. Ginsburg, for that. All right, it leads us up to... Item 14F, approve the Florida League of Cities items. And I guess, you know, we're looking at first who's going to be our delegate to the conference business meeting. And I would say we're choosing between Mr. Hill and Mr. Adams.
Yeah.
So, Counselor, what's your pleasure, you know?
The problem, who can go?
Any council member.
And yeah, but I mean, who's available? The... Business meeting, okay, the business meeting is normal time.
Yeah,
right,
okay.
Right.
Oh, okay, I'd like to nominate Jim Hill.
Second.
That sounds good to me. So Mr. Hill will be attending the business meeting. And then again, you know, any resolutions we're looking to submit, do you have any that come to mind now or any you want to think about?
I think we need... To put some pressure to, one, get the state out of our business again. We do this every year, but one item I think we need to look at is the rental properties, and to discourage the state from tying our hands. I want our hands untied so that we can make, you know, decent ordinances.
I think maybe what you're thinking about comes a little later at the administrative level. This is just resolutions to be submitted, like if we wanted to have our city named, you know, the 100th anniversary city or something like that. It's more ceremonial than anything else. Doesn't have to do with legislative session, which is in November.
No. I don't think that a resolution is not... The Florida League of Cities makes resolutions of the... and recommendations at this meeting in the business session.
No, the resolutions that they do at the thing are not the resolutions that are coming up for the legislative session. It's the resolutions that are approved at that meeting are, if a town names themselves a Sunset City, it's more ceremonial, or it really doesn't have anything to do with the legislation.
Fine.
Commemorative constitutional or federal issues. See, it says page 225.
Read that again. Let me get to the page.
225. It says Florida League of Cities also requests municipalities to submit resolutions for consideration which take a position on commemorative constitutional or federal issues. So it really wouldn't.
Well, wouldn't that be asking them to take a stand on a constitutional to allow us to have our own thing?
I guess you could. I mean.
Yeah, I would like Florida League of Cities to encourage federal folks to get it together and do something about gun control, and that the state take a look at the state laws for gun control. That's my suggestion. Take it or leave it. But those are the two issues I think the state needs to take a hard look at. The state has tied our hands as far as rental, although I read today that the county has done some things, and I was going to wait till my matters, but I'll do it now. I would like next time a discussion on what the county has done as far as taking a stand on rental properties, and if I think we need to look at that for us real close, because they've come with, if they can do it and get away with it legally, I think we need to do it. And we've already been told by the state that we had to repeal all of our gun issues. So
I tell you, that rental one's going to be kind of really
hairy,
especially with the way that Airbnb runs. You know, how are you going to know if somebody actually fills or whatever? So, but it'll be interesting to see.
Oh, yeah. Well, and let me tell you an interesting thing that came up with this, you know, the folks that were here. Mm-hmm. This is really cool. Thank you, Dory. Our Dory came up with a really good solution. The property that they were complaining about next door, kitty corner to them, is a homesteaded property. Homestead means the guy lives there. He can't rent it out.
Ooh.
He is being granted $50,000 homestead exemption. Let's hit him in the wallet. He's not a homesteader. So, I mean, there are little things that that these folks can go after. And other folks, if you have somebody who's renting out property, go find out. Is that property homesteaded? And there's a tax appraiser, and people need to know that.
Well, they have to be there 6 months, right?
I think if you claim it, yeah.
Yeah, but you can't rent it. You cannot rent homesteaded property.
Right.
And actually, you've got to be in there on the tax date, which is January 1st. That's where it's pegged. So if you're living there on January 1st, and it's your home, then you can get homestead exemption. No, not if you rent. No, you can't rent it.
But you're not allowed to rent. I this came up years ago. I know this. I saw this happen at another property in Orange Heights that was being rented. And that was the solution. So Dory, thank you, bless your heart. And people listening out there, if this is happening to you, check the homestead. That's a good place to start. That one the state can't take away yet. Those are my suggestions.
Those sound good to me. The one I have that pops in my head is one of the ones we recommended for when our representatives had the legislative session, and it was to consider, Mr. Ginsburg assisted with this one, is that any item that they do up there at the state level, does it impact home rule, and is this an unfunded mandate to have at the end of every piece of legislation that they pass, a yes or a no? So that would be a nice one to throw up there.
Yep.
Any other suggestions, comments? All right, so you got what we need? Mr. Ginsburg? All right. All right, it brings us up to public input. Anyone from the public wish to speak on any item not already on the agenda or discussed intensively in the past? Yes, sir.
Russell and Sebastian, I just got to say one thing here real quick. I want to thank you guys for coming over to Thorn Grove. The teachers and the students over there really liked your coming over and putting your input about how things are run. I know that for a fact. Now, I was here a while back, and I came up with a couple of things. Cumberland Farms, that sign says right turn only. Now, the other day, I wasn't on the bike, but there was traffic coming off of 512 onto Barber Street, taking a right-hand turn off of 512 onto Barber Street. There was couple of cars sitting there in Cumberland Farms. They were making left-hand turns when these cars were coming around the corner from 512. Now, nothing happened, but that's that big word, if. It could happen very easily because people just don't pay attention to the sign. Something's got to be done. Something has to be done before somebody gets hurt. And I don't want to be on the short end of the stick on my motorcycle either. But there's cars coming in there, and they're not going 3-4 miles an hour. They're going 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 miles an hour coming off of 512 onto Barber Street. And these cars coming out of Cumberland Farms, they don't look. They just go. Period.
Russ, a guy called me yesterday and said to thank me for fixing Cumberland Farms. I swear it was yesterday, and I said, geez, I hadn't seen it, and I don't even know who he was. Yeah. He just called to say thank you, so I thought we had that taken care of.
No, there's still a sign there, one big sign on the right-hand side says right-hand turn only, trucks at a certain weight.
Okay.
They're still taking left-hand turns out of Cumberland.
Okay, so what, we had the pavement issue, and I think we fixed that, the arrow, There was an arrow going straight. There was a pavement issue. And then there was...
Police were going to be out for a little bit, right?
Yeah. Watch.
I guess the only thing I can think of is maybe the pylons going along down the thing so you can't make the left-hand turn. Because, I mean, legally, you're not supposed to cross the double yellow line anyway. So if they are making a left...
They are making left-hand turns coming out of there, and they're crossing over that yellow line.
Right.
Big time.
It can be, you know, it's only a matter of time. And I know in the past I've seen several accidents that have been down around that area. Just like I brought up with you, the Laconia, when you're coming out of the Winn-Dixie and you got people shooting straight across,
straight across, right,
over
the Walgreens. Or,
and especially at certain times of the day when there's a lot of traffic, it's just a recipe for disaster.
Right. Absolutely.
So I don't know if we can come up with like those pylons to really ensure. And I think, again, maybe it's gotten a little better, but there are still some people that are making that left-hand turn, and they shouldn't be coming out of there.
And there's trucks taking left-hand turns out of there, too.
Right.
Waste management, for one.
Ooh, right. We can fix that.
Right. Okay. Waste management's come out of there. Some lawn companies have come out of there making left-hand turns out of Cumberland Farms, and there's a bunch of cars. Bunch of cars. The other problem I have is, I don't know if anybody came over to my place on Guava Street about the culverts. They did a good job digging out that little trench. I take care of mine, my neighbor takes care of his, and on so and forth and on. But underneath the culverts, underneath the driveways, over the years, it has collected dirt, and grass has grown, and I haven't got the power to clean them drains out. And I walk the streets around my neighborhood, and I see a lot of culverts that are just covered with dirt and grass. Now, if you're talking about drainage, there's a good example of it right off the bat, where that water can drain through there. And I've got standing water. While we just had a nice rainstorm here later on, earlier today, but we've had a substantial amount of rain over the past month or so, and the water's still standing, and it's not going anywhere because over the course of years, stuff is collected underneath them culverts, all the way down the street and on the other side of the street of Guava and all around the neighborhood, around Riviera and all of them streets. I don't know what can be done, but something's got to be done, and I can't get in there and do that because I haven't got the water pressure to clean out that culvert. Because you're talking like 17, 18 feet. I haven't got the power to do that. And you got that big truck, that big sucker truck. So if something could be done, it would be appreciated to clean them out so that water drains. One other thing, you brought up a subject. During the 2004 hurricanes, I brought this up here a number of years ago. I don't know if you remember that, Andrea, or not. But that big piece of aluminum that sits up on top of that tree, that's an eyesore.
It's still down there.
Yes, it is. It still is. It's still up in that fool's tree.
What street's that on, Rusty?
It's right there where Gore's office is.
That's what I
right
thought.
There. Yeah, right there on, right there.
It is.
Yeah, it's up in the tree. You can't miss it. It's got to be a 20-foot piece of aluminum there sitting in that tree. It's probably, the tree has probably grown around it over the years. But anyway, that's what I got to say. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir. I guess I got somebody I could put on that piece of aluminum. They might get it for scrap, you know. Anyone else from the public wish to speak? Yes, sir.
Mr. Mayor, my name is Graham Cox. I live at 1213 George Street. I'm very mindful of the procedures for public input and we'll follow the rules for the public input as proposed here. I'm making a new request to you, and it's dealing with the same topic that I have dealt with before, and that is the spraying of herbicides on the canal system. Some time ago, back in March, when I started looking at this project, I asked and had a conversation, several conversations with Applied Aquatics, Mr. Wayne Ferris, who is the manager. He was, after my initial conversations, he was told not to talk to me again. I intend to spend this summer at my cost and expense, not yours, investigating the pros and cons and the costs of the many of the 60 alternative ways to do non-toxic treatment of the canals. It would be very helpful if I could speak to Mr. Ferris and get his costs and opinions on various alternative means of doing it. He was very helpful to me in the conversations I've had. I do have a March email from him saying he's not allowed to talk to me on this topic. At the request of the city, I would ask that you lift that restriction so that I can talk to him. And I pledge to you, I will not be here to bug you in July and August, but we'll be back in October to report to you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I guess it wouldn't have to be us lifting any sort of ban. I think part of the reason he wouldn't go forward talking, there was some issues about a possible lawsuit. And then if somebody's speaking to him about possibly looking for his expert opinion, that would be under his direction whether he wants to answer or doesn't want to answer. He works and has a contract with us. Would that be correct, Mr. Griffin?
I believe that's correct. I don't remember placing any restrictions on Mr. Paris to talk to anybody. I mean, I don't think I can do that. I wouldn't be that presumptuous.
Right. But it would be up to him whether he wants to talk or doesn't want to talk. Because really, the only person he answers to is the city, because we have a contract for what we do. Would that be?
Correct.
Correct. Okay. So if somebody's asking him basically his opinion on any possible of other things, that would be up to that gentleman whether he wishes to or does not wish to. That has nothing to do with us at all.
Correct.
Yes, correct. Sir. Okay.
And I think, Mr. Cox, there were emails from other people who were, I think there were other requests, not just from you, and other, perhaps other phone calls. I don't remember all the details, but it wasn't just your requests and your comments that were going forward to Applied Aquatics. And so there was reference to lawsuit. There's reference made here to lawsuit that had nothing to do with you. I'd rather you just deal with Mr. Griffin directly. I think this is something you can settle with him and with the company.
I will happily provide Mr. Griffin an email that I got from Mr. Farris saying.
Come up, I can't hear you. I even with my hearing aids, then the public has to be able to hear you.
I will happily provide the city manager with the email that I got from Mr. Farris in March. After, if you remember, there was a meeting on the Monday with the city manager and you with Mr. Farris. You talked about whether you could use glyphosate or something else. Right after that meeting, I got an email from Mr. Farris saying he'd been requested by the city not to speak to me anymore on this topic. I'd like that request. I'd like
well,
that.
Yeah, get with
lifted.
Mr. Griffin.
I will.
And let Mr. Griffin settle that. And whatever Mr. Farris wants to tell you is fine. I know the city has provided you with information, and that's been another problem. The city has been accused of not providing information.
We have it.
You have it.
We have the contract.
Okay, but you...
And for all, as I understand the state law, the contract is in fact the permit, and for that I appreciate that.
Okay, well, again, you're... I appreciate you coming forward. We have had difficulty in the past with other folks coming here and misinforming the public that and accusing us of not providing information, discussing lawsuits, all the stuff that you don't want attached and doesn't come attached when you say Graham Cox. Okay, I know that because I've dealt with you for a long time. But there have been some stuff that's attached to the same issue. So it's all kind of coming into one. So you have to deal with that other issue too. And there's the guy.
Okay, I appreciate your
comments. He knows you're different than the other. If he doesn't, he's different, okay? This is a different guy.
What I'm trying to do for you is to do the homework for you to say, here are the alternatives, and here are the pros and cons, and here are the costs. And I can only do that if Mr. Farris is prepared to help me with some of those numbers.
But that's the thing is, Mr. Farris contracts with us for this spring. You asking him questions about these other things, that's up to him whether he wants to answer or not answer, because that's his business is with us. It's not, he doesn't answer to anybody but to Mr. Griffin, and that's it. He doesn't... You can't ask him his opinion. Maybe if you say, hey, look, if I'm going to throw you so much money, would you give me an opinion? Then he might, but he's not just available to give an opinion.
But as it stands right now, the only thing communication I have from him is that March memo that says, I've been asked not to talk to you. I just want to be able to lift that and say, can I please talk to him?
Well, I'm sure Mr. Griffin will send him an email. You can talk to him if you want to. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else from the public wish to speak? Yes, sir.
Ben Hocker, City of Sebastian. I'll make it quick. One, when you opened up the public input, you made a statement, and it says in here, opportunities not, or information not brought forward at this meeting. You put a little clause in there that said, hadn't been heard extensively prior. It's not in your paperwork here. Two, City Council will not debate an issue during public input. Well, congratulations. Maybe that has to be changed. And it says, if I have a problem, it's not debated up here, my interpretation, and you're going to tell me to go see the city manager. Just a comment on the public input. Now, you were looking at a bill to stop soliciting on our streets at certain roadways, et cetera. Would you kindly consider possibly putting that as public parks? We have an occupancy in our park system that's constantly asking for whatever, money, et cetera, people asking. I'm not pointing out any group. I'm just saying in our parks, we have that situation. It wouldn't hurt to put it on public parks.
Ooh. Is there a person or an organization soliciting money?
It's not, it's just a person.
A person?
A person. It's multiple people that are in our parks, and they're begging and saying, I'm out of work, and I need this, and I need that.
Right.
And so you might want to just consider putting that verbiage, instead of the roadway, encompass the public parks.
Well,
it's
I guess
happening
the thing
at the waterfront, at the boat ramp, at the yacht club, people walking through the park with their kids, etc. There's a center pavilion with these occupants that everybody has to pass by.
Right.
And I'll just leave it at that. Next, we have a fire, we have a police boat. 3 weeks ago, somebody made a sign and put the word volunteer on it, and a volunteer from the city was operating that boat. I have no idea what they were doing with it.
Wait, can you run that by me again? There's a police boat, and he put a sign, volunteer, on it?
Yes.
And then they went out in the river?
Yes.
On a volunteer police boat?
Yes.
Okay.
And there was only one person on the boat. I want to know, if that boat's out there, are these people certified for a life-saving technique, CPR? Do we have the paddles on that boat? What is happening here? The boat doesn't move, but all of a sudden, it went out one day. Maybe it went for maintenance. I don't know. But it was a volunteer in uniform with a sign that was tied up onto the overhead covering on the boat. And he brought it in, tied it up, had a hard time tying it up, and then washed it down and left. But again, it's a volunteer. A sign was on it. Are they certified if there was an emergency?
I guess not if he had to sign volunteer, but do you know the date of that? And they could probably look up and see when the boat
was
logged in or logged out. But I mean, I pretty much, it's probably not an emergency vehicle. It's the same as when you see the volunteer police cars going back and forth. They make runs first, they do traffic duty.
Okay, so maybe the guy was going to get gas in it. I don't know. But it doesn't move enough that it requires fuel.
Okay.
All right. The other thing, we've got motorized bicycles, electric or gas. They're running on our sidewalks. They're not licensed vehicles. They're going through the town. I know the reason that people have them, but that's still beside the point. They do need transportation. I don't see anything being done about it. And again, we're talking about our drainage system on the streets. I can drive down any number of streets and find vehicles consistently parked in the swales. Barber Street is a prime example. I haven't seen anybody stop and put a warning sticker on it. We used to do it up north. If you pulled into a plaza area where it was illegal to park, they had an 8.5 by 11 sticker that you had to get a blowtorch to take off of your window. They put it on the driver's window. It said, no parking. We could have a sticker like that that says no parking, and after they try and get that sticker off once or twice, they won't do it again. But nobody seems to be looking at this occurring in our town. And Andrew, you're right. There is an arrow coming out. to a one-way street the other way at Cumberland Farms, and they are doing horrendous turns and what have you. That's about all I got.
All right, so let me get back. The motorized bikes, are you talking the one that's got the pedals and they got the little motor that's there?
And there's also, yeah, the they're defined, I guess, as a moped.
Moped,
but
biped.
Under a 35 or a 30-mile speed limit, I had a moped for my kids,
right,
but I had to go get a plate for $5. It said right. New York.
Right, but right. You didn't need a special license for it either.
So they
could
we're
not, looking to see if there's any requirements.
Well, you couldn't use it with the plate unless the child was... had a learner's permit. That
actually,
was
I had one, didn't have a license, didn't need a license, as long as it had the plate. And you just pedaled up and it got it going, and it went on the 35.
Okay, well, but you have, where I came from, you needed a learner's permit to use it.
Right.
I'd assume that you'd need a license then, if it needs a plate.
Right.
I don't know what Florida law is. I'm a little too old for a moped.
I guess for the ones when you see people parking in the swales when they shouldn't be, you can call the city hotline, or you can call the police, to, you know, those people, because they should be ticketed if they are damaging our swales.
Well,
as far as then also you're talking about panhandlers or vagrants who are in the park, if you feel in any way intimidated or fear for your life, I would say contact the police, because there are laws, homeless people, they have special laws federally that protect them. But if they are being a nuisance, a public nuisance, and you feel at harm, you should report that.
I understand what you're saying. I'm just saying if you put it into the ordinance, it's, I'm not going to use the word panhandling, but it is.
We can't.
I know. That's why I'm saying soliciting of funds for whatever in the park. Let's include the park, and maybe we can have some resolution to the problem. And as far as cars parked on the road, I see the sheriff's cars driving down the road. I see our police driving down the road. I don't see anybody stopping and saying, hey, I got one of these warning tickets. Drop it on the windshield and drive away. It'd solve the problem.
Right.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir. Anyone else from the public wish to speak tonight? No? Okay.
Maybe that should go on our list to the federal, that's a Supreme Court issue, is tying our hands with, as far as panhandling. Though I want to stay away from that for a while. It needs to settle down. Never mind.
Sure?
Yep.
Okay. All right. Bring us up. Mr. Ginsburg, you have anything for us?
Nothing tonight, sir. Thank you.
And Mr. Griffin.
Yes, sir. Just one thing. On Monday, the 27th and the 28th, Tuesday, we are starting a tree removal and pruning at Riverview Park. So I am anticipating, depending on the size of the operation, that they will have at least part of the park roped off with yellow tape or some sort of safety devices. So everyone, please take note. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Ms. Williams, you have anything? Okay. Then that brings us up to city council matters, the charter officer evaluations. I guess I encourage people to do their charter officer evaluations and get them in and meet with each of the charter officers. Now, I know, Mr. Griffin, yours was done a couple months ago, so just leave me with Mr. Ginsburg's and then Ms. Williams.
I never received the one for Mr. Ginsburg. I'm remiss.
Nor did I. I didn't receive one for Mr. Ginsburg or for the city clerk.
Right, okay. So Cindy can send us for the city attorney and then the city clerk. And then is there any special time? Because I think Ms. Williams is through with her 3-month probationary period. Am I correct?
When is that up?
Yes, I believe it was it March, April, May, June. So it was 3 months. This is the last meeting in June.
Okay. Let me sharpen my pencil. All right. Because that's what I would have waited until she was off the...
Okay, yes. All right, Mr. Gilmore, you have anything?
Yeah, just a couple things. We had the Lagoon Compact Summit a couple weeks ago on Saturday up at FIT. And a couple things were, it was like a 4 or 5 hour session. And some of the things that were brought out were kind of interesting. One of the things I brought up earlier, and that is that the natural shorelines that they've found that they do much better during hurricanes than storm, what do you call the panels that you put in the
seawall?
The seawalls. The natural shoreline of mangroves or just whatever aquatic plants does a good job of moderating storm surge, and it also is good for the lagoon. So going forward, you know, I'd like for us to kind of study that rather than put in a seawall and then have, you know, issues down the road. If we do have actual sea rise rising, and things are getting warmer, you know, the seawalls may, you know, may be an issue that we don't want to have to get involved with. The other thing that came out in that summit was that cities and counties really kind of have to lead by example. If we want citizens to pay attention to our fertilizer ordinances and all the things that we're trying to do to do the right thing for water quality, we kind of have to take the bull by the horns, and I think we should set an example and lead by example. And one of the issues that I have is that cities, municipalities, and counties have exempted themselves from our fertilizer ordinance. The fertilizers that's being applied to the golf course has phosphorus in it. I realize that you need phosphorus for palms, but I witnessed that being put on stuff other than palms. And I looked at the percentages, and the company that has got the contract for us, we should be able to have some input and say, don't buy that stuff anymore. We don't need phosphorus on our golf courses. So I would just like us to lead by example and you know, contact the golf course folks that do our maintenance and say, please don't buy that anymore that has phosphorus in it. We should lead by example. That's all I have.
All right. Thank you. All right. Ms. Coy.
Thank you. I have two items this evening. Well, this goes into lead by example. We had an issue a week ago Sunday. I received a phone call at home about 9 o'clock in the morning from a local citizen who was very frustrated that one of our local business owners had contracted a pressure washer down on Riverview Drive, and they were pressure washing and degreasing range equipment and restaurant equipment directly into our stormwater. I was in just total disbelief and said, I'm going down. I jumped into my car and got down there just in time to see the guy cleaning up and was finished. Sometimes I'm not real good at being calm. This was one of those. I'm like, what are you doing? And he said he was doing nothing wrong. He's done it before, yada, yada, yada. He's out of Fort Pierce. He's a pressure washing guy. And I said, what are you putting in there? And he comes, hands me this spray bottle with pink stuff in it, and it was pretty potent stuff. I sniffed it. And I said, what is that? He didn't know. He said, it's on the name of the barrel. It's back at the office. I said, you mean to tell me you're running around spraying stuff down my stormwater thing here, and you don't even have a name for it? You can't tell me what chemical this is? Well, that's not the worst part of the story. The part that upsets me even more, and I think this doesn't reflect real well on us, but it's something we can fix, and I think we fixed it, but I'm saying this publicly to ensure that this never, ever happens again. The frustrating part to me was that Sunday before the individual called me, they called the police department and an officer showed up and didn't do anything because he didn't know what to do. I was thumbing through ordinances when I got home, looking. It was difficult and I couldn't find, I found little bits and pieces here. But my gut was telling me, you can't do this. This is so wrong. Code enforcement went to investigate this on Tuesday and found nothing wrong. And it wasn't until Thursday that another member of staff, I mean, I'm frustrated at this point. I'm going, I know this is wrong. I know it's wrong. We've got to have this somewhere. Came up with the ordinance, plus there's DEP, there's health department. Okay, so what's the good news out of all this? There's been a learning curve in the city. I've been told that the police department now has been informed, and I really want to reinforce that, you know, if one of our officers get called and somebody's dumping stuff down a stormwater drain that's going out, especially one right there, any stormwater drain. This goes for residents too. If you're dumping stuff into the system, you're wrong. And we now know you're wrong. We now know who to call right away. And oh, by the way, we have citizens out there watching because they called me. They called the police. So our police now know that this is a no-no. Our code enforcement officers know. I think we need to make an attempt to let the local business owners, especially immediately on the riverfront, that don't get a hose and rinse stuff down the drain. Anything, nothing, nada, zero. So it was a big disappointment to me that it took that long, because I thought we all knew better, but we don't. I'm really hoping the city learned that. I know I've already made it a point. I have stopped at a whole bunch of businesses on the riverfront personally and talked to the owners. Don't do this, because it will cost you dearly the next time it happens. There are penalties for this. By the way, the perpetrator cleaned out, paid for our vents to be cleaned out. What are they? The screens, the very expensive baffle box screens, has paid for that to be cleaned out. The business pressure washer guy has been told by the health department if he ever gets caught doing that again, it could be civil and criminal offense. So it's no laughing matter, folks. I'm disappointed it took us that long. But we know now. And citizens are watching. Thank you, anonymous citizen. I truly don't know who this guy is. Thank you for calling. And you taught us something, and we won't do it again, I promise. But, well, I'm watching now. I know who to call now immediately. And there will be a fine. That's item number one. Item number two. At our last city council meeting, I was really dismayed at some comments that were made. And these are comments that were also made at one of our board meetings that was taped and that I got to watch. And I'm really concerned I'm having people asking me, what does this mean? And I think it's time now to clear the air. The specific comments at the last meeting were comments concerning shame on the city of Sebastian, and I did nothing wrong, and I didn't direct any member of staff. And these comments were made by Mr. Gilmore. So I would, at this time, like Mr. Gilmore, to please explain what shame the city of Sebastian should have. I'm asking.
The Charter Review Committee thought it was important enough to include language that would prevent this from ever happening again.
What? Prevent what, please? That, I want you to be specific, please.
The having three council members decide that they want to change horses in midstream, mayors in mid-year, however you want to slice it or dice it, without charges, without any specific charge ever, an amorphous talking to staff, directing staff, but yet never having a direct item on this date, yada, yada, yada. I spend an awful lot of time in City Hall doing work, investigating stuff that we vote on. Others don't. I don't have a problem with that. But for a council to say it's wrong for me to spend 20 or 30 hours in City Hall, that's not your place.
This council never told you. Point of order.
You ask me a question, I'm going to finish it. I made some comments, and I think there is some issues here, and I'm concerned about the city. I really am. Because when you allow this to go on, my comments that every meeting we could have a reorganization, not that it's going to happen, but we have the possibility now of three council members, and oh, by the way, you may not be on the winning side this time. You may have three people who say, well, we don't like your choice of mayor. We want to change mayors. We want a reorganization. And every other month, we could have a new mayor here, and that's ridiculous. It makes the city look small. And I don't want to ever see that happen again. But we voted last time to leave the wording in the charter that allows that to happen. And I will continue to say that I did nothing wrong. I never directed staff. So there.
Okay. Thank you. So if I were to tell you that I have had conversations with five staff members who you have directed or have overheard you directing people, and that three of them have written letters that are on file, that's not true. I have talked to these staff members. And I'm going to look you dead in the eye and tell you, you weren't let go on a whim. And I can't speak for the other two council members, but I'm going to tell you why I voted you out as mayor. Because you've overstepped your bounds time and time again. Why didn't it come up? Well, one time, you walked right out. And the other times, I'm going to take part of the blame because I was trying to protect our staff members. And I really thought that we were protecting the personnel and doing the right thing and keeping it private. But then it goes and the public doesn't know. And we kept this private. And by keeping it private, the only shame in this is that we didn't protect them, we protected you. because their complaints were not brought to the public. There are complaints. I have talked to the people. That's why I voted to have you removed as mayor. And there are many other
And wait a second now. I've seen you directing staff. I've seen you in the middle of the street talking to a police officer trying to get him to arrest people. I've seen you do that.
Oh, really? Let's
yes,
turn,
really.
Let's turn it to me. We're talking about you, and that's classic. Classic. If you want to talk about me, raise complaints, file the complaint. We're talking about Mr. Gilmore.
Every item
Mr. Gilmore,
you can,
we're talking about
every
you
Every
right
item
now.
That you can bring up, I talk to staff. Of course I talk to staff. I request things.
Mr. Gilmore, the fact is, we're not talking about you talking and requesting. We're talking about
Let me give you an instance.
We were talking about you.
I'm very proud of what I've done for the city. There's lots of stuff that you don't know that I've done on my own that, okay, playing golf. Talk to a fellow that lives on Main Street. He says, you know, we've got this situation on Main Street, and, you know, it's really weird when you come down to Main Street, you can't see cars coming. You know, he almost got hit a couple times. He says, I've got a real simple situation how we can fix that. I said, well, what's that? He says, well, just have it so that you can't go all the way straight on Main Street, that you have to take that and make a left, okay? I said, gee, that makes a lot of sense. And he drew it out for me, and I said, well, let me talk to the engineer. I went to Frank Watanabe, and I said, hey, this is what this fella told me. Does it make sense to you? And I showed him, and he said, that's great. We'll do it. We're in the process of redoing Main Street. He says, that's easy. We can do that. Now, I didn't ask him. I didn't direct him. I didn't tell him to do that. I shared something that a citizen of Sebastian showed me, and he'd lived on Payne Street for 25 years. And you know what? Here's the thing. It was done, and then Mr. Griffin told me that was directing staff. No, that's not directing staff. That's asking a question, and he says it's a great idea. I didn't tell him to do it. I didn't direct him to do it. And I never have. I wouldn't be like that. I wouldn't say, do this for me. I'm not that type of person.
You never yelled at a volunteer down here and had her in tears because she didn't recognize you? She didn't know who you were? She didn't know you were the mayor?
No, I didn't yell at her.
Yeah?
Absolutely not.
Okay. You didn't direct staff to do your water samples on numerous occasions and get them done ASAP now or heads will
no,
roll.
No.
Wait a second.
I went to the personal expense of drawing those samples, bringing them in. I didn't direct staff. I put a note on there, please test these. Now we have people in there we hired to do that work. And as you well know, maybe you don't know, the testing has to be done within 48 hours or it's worthless. You have to test the water within 48 hours or the results are not going to be good, okay? So I went to the trouble to take the samples in. This was right after this person was hired to do that work. I left them in the lab with a note, please run the tests. And they weren't done. And I was, I was upset. And I did talk to her. I didn't direct her. I mean, this is her job. I was doing part of her job. And I don't really want to have any more conversations here, so I'm going to take a page from your playbook, and I'm not going to put up with this any more of this crap. Okay, so
have a nice
meeting adjourned for me.
You're not the mayor, sir, and that's part of the problem. You don't get it. You just don't get it. So feel free to leave, because I'm not done.
Have fun.
Okay. Well, that was very adult. But that's part of the reason that we've never had this conversation. And people are asking me, and the people have a right to know. We did not just randomly decide that he shouldn't be mayor anymore. There were lots of events that led up to this, and his behavior and actions, some that you just got to see here, are it. I have personal experience. You were at the meeting with the art club workshop. Very unprofessional behavior, loud voices, insisting, we're a 501c whatever, whatever, and throwing through paperwork at me, threw it at me, saying, here's our art club lease. And it made me laugh because it was the senior center lease. Yet, we never got beyond that. We had a whole room of people riled up for nothing, for nothing. And we have people now that believe that absolutely nothing happened, and that three people sitting up here, Mr. McPartlin, myself, and Mr. Hill, just randomly decided this guy needs to be out. We don't want a mayor anymore. There were reasons. I just told you what my reasons are. It's up to the other two council members to share, if they choose, what their reasons were. But it's on file. The complaints are there. Mr. City Manager, has anyone complained to you about being directed?
Yes.
I'm going to leave it at that. It's not just Andrea. I'm not on a witch hunt. A lot has happened. But I will not allow someone to continue on and be, you just heard him say again tonight, I did not direct staff. He just gave some examples where he did. We have it in writing. And for him to say he never did and then turn around and give us examples, on the radio station he gave an example. Shame on the city. The only shame is that we didn't bring this forward. Mr. Mayor, I really regret the fact that we did not have this discussion earlier, because we have some employees that were sitting out there shaking in their shoes, thinking they were going to get fired. I can't fire anybody except him, and her. And it takes two other people up here to do that. So, there was a good reason, in my mind. I didn't take that lightly. And if we have to do it again, it's going to be for a good reason. So, I think it's time for me to go home and get my blood pressure down. But that's it, folks. There was a reason. I'd be happy to talk to anybody about this. The people that this occurred to, I have talked to, and I have their permission to share the stories. We were keeping it quiet in order to protect them, and we are actually hurting them. And for the perpetrator to sit back and say, I did not do that, every time that is being said, that's a slap in the face to the people that he did direct. It's a slap in their face, because he's calling them liars now. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Have a nice night.
Oh, you're welcome.
Your turn.
My turn. I guess it's a boundaries issue. And just knowing the boundaries and the chain of command, that's the only way I've ever tried to live it. All the questions I have for the city, I direct through Mr. Griffin, Mr. Ginsburg, or I haven't directed any through Jeanette really yet, but the city clerk for that matter. And it's just, yes, I've gotten a lot of questions about what happened, and it's disparaging to think that three council members up here got together in a back room and decided we were going to make a change, which did not happen. Because the only time we discuss anything is when we're up here and all together. So I'll just leave it at that. I have no items for tonight, so this meeting will be adjourned, and we'll see you in July. Good night.